Through the lens of the ancient wisdom of scripture, this week, President Biden stopped by Mother Emanuel AME Church and delivered an obviously partisan political speech. This habit is not unique to Biden. Trump also stepped on stage at FBC Dallas to massive cheers and chants just a few years ago. The question for believers is, should the president ever be given the pulpit? Pop star and talk show host Kelly Clarkson has been doling out love and marriage advice post-divorce that has been roundly accepted as pure gold by the culture. However, we will quickly see that her musings on matrimony do not stack up when scrutinized through the lens of ancient wisdom. Internationally, shipping lanes have been disrupted by the Houthi pirates. The West responded with a show of force, but will it make any difference? More importantly, how is it that a relatively underpowered group of terrorists has such an outsized influence? All that and one look at the latest release from Lil Nas X titled J Christ. The music video depicts the rapper as an effeminate Jesus on the cross, an angel playing basketball against the devil, and an angelic cheerleader along with many other scenes. Is this an example of artistic expression, or is it just straight up blasphemy? Let's find out together on episode 46 of the Clayton Tyner Podcast. Well, welcome to episode 46. I want to thank everyone who has been following the channel. I want to remind you to like, comment, and most importantly, subscribe to the channel. Man, we have been just frozen in the 800s. Wow. So make sure you're doing your part, subscribing at youtube.com/Clayton Tyner. If you are an audio only listener, come on over to youtube.com/Clayton Tyner. Let's get those subscriber counts up. Also, if you're looking to support the podcast, you can go to patreon.com/Clayton Tyner. Again, that's T-Y-N-E-R. If you're listening to this early, then it's not too late for you to sign up and be a part of this month's live Q&A, where instead of me just talking to you through a stream, we actually get in a Google Meet together and get to have really great, robust conversations. So there are a lot of resources I'm trying to offer in exchange for your support, trying to cover the cost, some of what it takes to run the podcast. So why does the Clayton Tyner Podcast exist? We live in a very polarized world. We're very politically polarized. We're very religiously polarized. And what I'm seeking to do is to not just be unaware of what's going on in the world, but to look at the cultural happenings, the things that are in the news, and approach them to the best of my ability through an actual biblical standpoint. And what that tends to do is help us find a little bit of nuance and to really root our lives in what a Christian worldview should lead us towards. And so that is our goal. Without further ado, let's get to our 3 points. Over the years, politicians have made it a habit to find churches that will host them and not just let them sit in the seats, but actually turn over the pulpit to them. We see this increasingly through the years, and this is something that has happened back through the decades. We have a few examples in just the last couple of years, and one from this week where President Biden visited Mother Emanuel Church, and this was the site in South Carolina of a terrible shooting years and years ago. Now, when the presidents get up in the pulpit, which again, if you're at a Sunday service and you're inside the building where your church happens to meet, the expectation of what comes off the stage is spiritual guidance, spiritual edification. It's like Paul told Timothy that our job is the building up the saints in order to do the work of ministry. That is the expectation. Is that what typically happens when a politician gets on a church stage?
No,
of course it's not. What ends up happening is they leverage this moment to audiences that are typically very happy to see them there, and they give politically divisive statements. Is this okay? Should we allow presidents and other politicians to use a Sunday morning service in order to deliver a political message? Here is Joe Biden in his latest stop, and here's part of his speech. Obviously political. This was a longer, he's calling it a sermon. I would not classify it as a sermon because he did not exegete any scripture and there was no instruction for the church on a spiritual level. But here's one of the clips that got people really fired up.
Thing they don't have.
They don't have respect for the 81 million people who voted the other way.
Wow.
Voted for my candidacy. And voted to end the presidency. In their world, these Americans, including you, don't count. But that's not the real world. That's not democracy. That's not America. In America, we all count. In America, we witness to serve all those who, in fact, participate. And losers are taught to concede when they lose. And he's a loser.
So, if you are on the left of things politically, then, I mean, that's just kind of red meat thrown to you, calling Donald Trump a loser. Look, if he's at one of his campaign stops, President Trump is not afraid to call someone a loser, fight fire with fire. I don't like it. I wish we could have better candidates. That's where we're at. What makes me uncomfortable is standing behind a pulpit with the stained glass behind you, people sitting in pews. They came for Sunday service, and instead they're getting not just a political message, but about as divisive of a message as possible. And what he's saying, and this is kind of how things are framed and how politically divided we are, is that Trump and everyone who voted for Trump, which is tens of millions of Americans, that all of them are some level of racist. All of them discount everyone. All of them are a threat to democracy. You know, like almost half the country is apparently a threat to democracy. And that's what's being told from the stage at a church. A few years ago, this made a lot of news as well. President Trump was invited by the senior pastor of FBC Dallas. And here's him getting as well just a massive ovation as he takes the stage. Let's look at that.
The foyer of the White House, he invited me to come up to the podium and share with the group what the real meaning of Christmas was.
This is the senior pastor.
Prayer. So I thought, Mr. President, since you are back in our house of worship today and our guest, I'd return the compliment. We would love for you to come and share whatever is on your heart, but especially a Christmas greeting for us. Would you join me in welcoming our great friend and the 45th president of the United States of America, President Donald J. Trump. Come on up.
All over the earth.
So phones out, everybody on their feet, everybody excited. Here in just a second, we will look at what Trump said. Now, the pastor, Robert Jeffers, I believe is his name, he's making the point, you know, Trump invited me to come to his thing. And so now, you know, Trump's here, so I'm going to invite him and hand him over the pulpit. Is that the same thing? Is asking a pastor to share a prayer at a political event the same thing as asking a politician to share a message, potentially a political message, to your congregation? And so let's look at a little bit of what Trump had to say at FBC Dallas.
Robert, I want to thank you so much. You know, you never told me how beautiful this is. This is some real place. What a job you've done, too. Highly respected man. And it is true, I was a little insulted when I first met him. I met him through watching television. He does very well on television and spreading the word. And he started talking about a man that he watched and he's been watching. And he may not know the Bible as well as all of us, but he loves God, he loves Jesus. And he's a leader, and he's going to lead us into great things in helping and saving Christianity. And we've done a real job. And as you know, we're in trouble now. We're in trouble. I think our nation's in great trouble.
So now it's going to get political. And I listened to the rest of this clip so that you don't have to. And Trump did make an attempt. He started reading from a script. Right now he's shooting from the hip like he likes to do. He read from a script. He told a little bit of the Christmas story. But everything leading up to it was a campaign stop, no bones about it. And then how he ended, make no mistake, was a campaign stop. One of the last things he says is, and let's make America great again. Well, that is the call for a political movement. That is not the call for the movement of Jesus. That is not our instructions. Our job is not to make America great again. Now, if everyone actually submits to the word of God and lives that way, and Christians take their faith spiritually, things will get better around us and we will be a light in a world of darkness. But We know what that statement means, and it is now attached to Trump and Trump alone. That is MAGA, Make America Great Again. We see this all the time. We saw Hillary Clinton go into a primarily black church and all of a sudden have an accent that no one had ever heard her have before. The cringiest thing that's ever happened, maybe in politics ever. We just saw DA Fannie Willis, who is the one prosecuting Trump in one of his many cases, who is now under some controversy. The first place she responded to it was from the pulpit of her church. And so churches are being leveraged for political means. And is that okay? When you look back at one of the founding principles of America, it was the separation of church and state. And this was important because we were breaking off from England. And in England, there is a state church. So the state and church are completely tied together. But when you read the history of the separation of church and state, you learn that that was not for the state's sake. It was not this idea of keeping God out of the state. It was actually for the sake of the church. It was protecting the church from political influence. It was protecting the church from political actors. This is really rooted. I mean, one of the key concepts in scriptures that shows this separation is in Matthew chapter 22, when Jesus said to them, give then to Caesar the things that are Caesar's and give to God the things that are God's. They were asking Jesus whether or not they should pay taxes to Caesar, and Caesar and all of Rome had come in and occupied Israel, and nobody was happy about it. He says, give to Caesar what is Caesar's. Make that separate and give to God what belongs to God. This is a separate thing, and it is a sanctified thing, and it is a holy thing, and it has an intentional purpose. Here's what Paul said to Timothy, a younger pastor that he was mentoring in 2 Timothy 2. He says, no one serving as a soldier gets entangled in the concerns of civilian life. He seeks to please the commanding officer. Now, he is using the metaphor of Christians as soldiers in a spiritual battle. And he says, no one serving as a soldier gets entangled in the concerns of civilian life. It's a little bit of an interesting metaphor, because it kind of reverses where we're at right now. No one who is serving as a servant of God, serving in the Lord's army, should get themselves entangled inside all of the political drama going on around them. He goes on to say, also, if anyone competes as an athlete, he is not crowned unless he competes according to the rules. The separation of church and state was not for the state. It was for the church. It was to set it apart as holy and separate. This doesn't mean that Christians don't have political convictions. Doesn't mean we don't live those convictions out. It doesn't mean that we can't fight for the political means that we see as important for the progress of our society. What it means is that none of those things usurp our first calling and our first purpose and our first commandment, which is to love God and to love the people around us. And whether you are Mother Emanuel AME Church and President Biden is there and he's giving a politically polarizing message, if there is someone there who is more on the right conservatively, if there is somebody there who happened to show up that week just looking for a church to go to, who voted for Trump in the last election, all of a sudden it's very clear that they're not welcome there. It's a divisive message from the pulpit, which is supposed to be calling all people together under God's law and guidance. If you showed up to FBC Dallas and in 2020 you had voted for Biden, you, as everyone stands up and gives a 45-second standing applause to President Trump, and then he goes up and talks about how we got to make America great again, you're not going to feel welcome. You're probably never, ever going back there. And so as soon as we become overtly political, now there are politics is just the idea of the organizational principles of how your country runs. You know, it's from the Greek word polis, P-O-L-I-S, which just means the city, like the people who make up the city. How are we going to organize ourselves? And so scripture has something to say about everything, but we are making spiritual points that might inform our political principles. We're not starting with partisan political ideas and then trying to shoehorn Christ into them. And here's the problem. People see this on the Trump side and they call it Christian nationalism. And then you might call what happened at Mother Emanuel Church for the people who are giving standing ovations to Biden, his agenda, that would might be called something like Christian progressivism. Well, whichever side of that spectrum you're on, whether it's nationalism or progressivism, any adjective that is used to modify what the church is moves the church off course. Anytime we try and put some kind of modifier onto church, modifier onto Christianity, which is the movement that is organized under the church, the movement of Jesus. Anytime we talk about progressive Christianity, anytime we talk about I'm a Republican Christian, I'm a liberal Christian, you can be a Christian who votes Republican. You can be a Christian who votes as a Democrat. But if you're a Republican Christian and now something is modifying what it actually means for you to be a Christian, you're just simply off course. Being a Christian is its own thing. It means that you have put your faith in Jesus. It means that your adoption has been purchased by the blood of Christ. It means that you are now seeking to follow Jesus with your life. It means you're going to stand before the judgment seat of Christ at the end of your life. That's what it means. And by adding to it, you are actually taking away from it. Most importantly, by putting a politician in the pulpit, you are trading the church's glorious purpose for the culture's status quo. And we know our purpose. We have our marching orders. They were given to us by Jesus. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and in the name of the Holy Spirit. And anything we do that is unnecessary, that becomes divisive. Look, the gospel is divisive enough. You're calling people to die to themselves. You're calling people to be sexually chaste. You're calling people to put others before themselves. The gospel, like following that and following Christ, is divisive enough. When we cause unnecessary division, then we are taking lives that are hanging in the balance between heaven and hell, and we are a stumbling block to them. And someday we will stand before Jesus and we will have to give an answer for why we did that. Kelly Clarkson, famous pop star, winner of the very first season of American Idol, and now talk show host, has recently gone through a very public divorce. She's starting to speak out on it, and she is giving love and marriage advice through the lens of her own experience. The question is, does this advice stack up to the ancient wisdom of how love, relationships, and marriage actually works? Let's look at one of these interviews via TikTok.
But I don't know, I've said this in an interview recently, and I, you know, don't think I'd ever said that, but I think for me, love has always come with this like elephant in the room of like sadness. And I didn't really realize that, because that's how you're a human, you're born, you grow up around what you grow up around, obviously nurture and nature, but like those behavioral things that you learn as a child, that impacts you without you even realizing how much so, right? So I don't know, I think I've always kind of, I've known love is not forever, and I don't mean that to sound depressing, but I also think there's a lot of pressure we put on that word. And sometimes love is looking at someone and going, this is not good. Like, this is not good for you. This is not good for me. Sometimes that's true love, of knowing that. And that's a hard thing to face. But when you do, I think you grow and you see, like, maybe we're putting too much pressure on that, on what love is. Like, you know, and it's okay too for things to have seasons in life, like relationships or friendships or, you know, things like that. I think everything has to be so final, you know, for us sometimes. And humans, we complicate that. And sometimes it's not that, you know.
So her advice in part is that love is not forever. She admits that there's always been this elephant in the room and that love always kind of brings out this deep sadness in her. And so, of course, all of this leads you to the question I'm sure you're dying to know. What is love? And I'm so glad you asked, because sometimes I've wondered, what is love? And how do we even discover that? And where do we go to look for that? And if you really want to know, what is love? Okay, I promise I won't do that again. If you really want to know, then we have to get a better definition than the definition that Kelly Clarkson seems to be working with. And really our entire culture, deeply misunderstands what love is. And she says, love is not forever, which I don't know Kelly Clarkson. I don't know her spiritual condition. I don't know what she thinks about, you know, Jesus, and I don't know her view on scripture. But is actually the opposite of what scripture teaches. Love is the one thing that can endure forever. True love, if we understand it properly and we understand how it's been understood throughout history until our cultural moment where everything is based on our own feelings, emotions, and convenience, love is that one thing that is eternal in nature. As a matter of fact, scripture defines love as God. God is love, and God is the one transcendent being who is timeless, literally forever. Everything else will fade. The grass withers and the flower fades, but is the word of God that stands forever. God is Alpha and Omega, beginning and end. He is the one who from his vantage point sees the ends from the beginning and the beginnings from the end. Time doesn't exist with him. He is the definition of eternity, and he's the definition of love. And our culture deeply misunderstands what love is. And we define it as the things that we feel, or we define it as what we get out of it. Here's a few things the scripture says in Ephesians 5. It says, therefore, be imitators of God, who is love. Be imitators of God as dearly loved children, and walk in love as Christ also loved us and gave himself for us, a sacrificial and a fragrant offering to God. Jesus also told his disciples, greater love has no person than this, that he would lay his life down for his friends. Now, Kelly Clarkson did say one thing that's true. She said, part of love is being able to look at a relational situation and say, this isn't good, or things aren't working. And a lot of times people think that passivity is love, that you just allow yourself to get beat up and walked all over. You allow people you're in relationship with to have terrible habits or infringe on your boundaries. That's not love at all. Love is, in fact, looking at someone and saying, hey, this isn't great. And we need to work on this, and we need a plan, and you need to know how this is affecting me. But the next step of that is where the love actually comes and undergirds you. And because love is forever, and because love lasts, and because you can depend on love, you're able to say to that person, especially in a marriage, we are going to work through this, and we can overcome this because we have committed to love one another, and our love isn't going anywhere. So we can resolve this situation, and we have the grace that we need because we love each other, and we have the forgiveness that we need because we love each other, and we're going to find the resources together that we need, and love is going to undergird us in that journey. In Colossians, it says, therefore, as God's chosen ones, holy and dearly loved, put on compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience, bearing with one another, and forgiving one another if anyone has a grievance against you. Just as the Lord has forgiven you, so you are also to forgive. And above all, put on love, which is the perfect bond of unity. If you are exercising these things in your life and in your relationships, let's look at them again. Compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, patience, bearing with one another, forgiving one another. If you are able to forgive, realizing that you had an immeasurable, uncountable debt against the God of the universe, and he forgave it at the cost of his own life. And so you should forgive others when you can really forgive the people around you. And you cover all of that in love, then love is the perfect bond of unity. Even when things aren't great, even in difficult seasons, this is why when we stand up and we make our commitment to each other in marriage, we give these vows. And people say these vows, but they're so counterculture to how we're wired that we don't really even realize what we're committing to for better or for worse, in sickness and in health, till death do us part, a covenant and commitment, which represents the covenant between us and God, who he actually sealed with the Holy Spirit at the cost of the life of Jesus on the cross. We don't understand what that actually means and the power that it has. And in our culture, the advice you're hearing all the time from pop stars and influencers is, man, if it's not working for you and if you don't feel fulfilled, right, that's a feeling. If you're not in a good emotional space, if you're in a really long, rough season, then divorce. You know, your life as an individual is too important, not realizing that the dissolution of the most important covenants we can make human to human over and over and over again at about 40% rate in marriages, 40% divorce rate, we don't realize what we're doing to the very fabric of society. And we look around and we wonder why our kids are so anxious and struggling with their mental health. And we wonder why the world has devolved into so much loneliness. And we wonder why suicide rates are at our all-time high. The most important covenant that we can make human to human, we have downgraded to the level of, you know, what real love is just walking away if things aren't everything that you want them to be. Love often results in feelings, but it is rooted in a commitment. And when feelings drive our decisions, we have placed the relational cart before the horse. When it's about how we feel, when it's about our emotions, we have things backwards. It starts with a commitment. And the commitment in the marriage vows says, look, whatever happens. I mean, that's the vows could just be, hey, I give myself to you, literally whatever happens. Now, scripture has a couple of carve outs. You know, if someone is just committing adultery on you all the time, that's a grace carve out for you to step out of that. If someone is abusing you all the time, or if someone abandons you, then you have the right to go. And in scripture, it says that God allows you out and you get to go and pursue life and potentially pursue marriage. But that's it. I mean, those are the three things in scripture. Not we weren't really getting along and, you know, everything was so stressful and I just, you know, couldn't really see a future with him. Like none of those things. In Matthew 19, it says, haven't you read? Jesus replied that he who created them in the beginning made them male and female. And he said, for this reason, a man will leave his father and his mother and be joined to his wife and the two will become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but they're one. And therefore what God has joined together, let no one separate, including them. And in scripture, there are different words for love. There's eros, which is erotic love, and that is kept in scripture just between a man and his wife. And of course, we don't do that in the culture. And so we have so downgraded sex and sexual activity by the time we get into a marriage that it isn't something special inside of our marriage, and maybe we could fix that to our advantage. And then there is philo, which is love between brothers and love between friends. And then there is agape love, and this is the love of God, and this is the love God has for us, mediated through the covenant of Christ on the cross through our faith. And this is the kind of love we are to aspire to in our marriage, the kind that makes us give a vow that says, I'm yours and I'm not going anywhere, no matter what. And that is the advice that we actually need, that you are making a commitment and you should make it seriously and you should think about the commitment and you should hold yourself to it. In international news, the Houthis, which are a somewhat small terrorist organization, at least small comparatively to who they are up against, are disrupting the entire international shipping routes, causing prices to spike. Who are the Houthis and how do they have so much outsized power? Let's look at this article from The Guardian. Who are the Houthis? They are a Yemeni militia group named after their founder, Hussein Badreddin al-Houthi. I'm great at names. And representing the Zaydi branch of Shia Islam, they emerged in the 1980s in opposition to Saudi Arabia's religious influence in Yemen. The group, which has an estimated 20,000 fighters and whose official name is Ansar Allah, runs most of the west of the country and is in charge of its Red Sea coastline. What is the group's relationship with Iran? The Houthis are backed by Iran as part of its longstanding hostility with Saudi Arabia and are supporting Hamas in the war in Gaza. Soon after the Hamas massacre on 7th of October, the Houthi leader said his forces were ready to move in the hundreds of thousands to join the Palestinian people and confront the enemy. So what has been happening in the Red Sea? The Red Sea, one of the world's most densely packed shipping channels, lies south of the Suez Canal, the most significant waterway connecting Europe to Asia and East Africa. Yemen is situated along the sea's southeast coast, where it meets the Gulf of Aden. Shortly after the start of the Gaza War, the Houthis began launching missile and drone attacks at vessels in the Red Sea, most of which were intercepted by U.S. and Israeli countermeasures. Now, I want us to also look at what this is causing. Houthi attacks on shipping in the Red Sea risk reigniting global supply chain crises. Attacks by the Iran-backed Houthi militants on commercial shipping vessels in the Red Sea, a critical juncture point for world trade, risk reigniting a supply chain crisis just as the global economy begins to recover from high inflation, chronic shortages, and bottlenecks. Shipping costs are already on the rise 8 weeks after the Yemeni rebel group first began targeting ships sailing through the Red Sea and the Suez Canal. About 15% of world shipping traffic, including 30% of global container trade, passes through the Suez Canal. But to avoid being attacked or having their cargo stolen, many ships are instead sailing around the Cape of Good Hope, which is the long way around the continent of Africa. That's who the Houthis are. That's what they're up to right now in the Red Sea. And this is what they could potentially cause and are already causing. Major shipping businesses have already said, we're just going to go the long way, which means it's going to cost more fuel, which means they're going to have to offset the cost of that fuel, which means they're going to have to charge more to the companies, which means the companies are going to have to raise their prices, which means this comparatively small, they keep calling militants, terrorist group, they are potentially going to cause the worldwide cost of almost all goods to increase by some percentage. And you're at home thinking, I'm already paying 30% more for groceries than I was 2 years ago.
Wow.
And I'm already paying significantly more for gas than I was paying 3 years ago. And now some guys who have low grade military tech, but who have a lot of passion and a lot of clarity of vision are potentially going to make things even more expensive. The question we should be asking, with all of the military prowess of the West, I mean, just America alone, the greatest standing military in the world, is how are the Houthis so powerful? How is this small group having so much influence? What happened last week is there was a targeted airstrike by a coalition of Western countries who took out some of their bases. They did this very strategically. They made sure that the majority of bases were empty by giving some level of warning ahead of time, minimizing civilian casualty to try and avoid World War III by Iran going to war with America. This did not seem to deter them at all. Millions of people marched on the streets of Yemen. They decided they are going to double down. They are not afraid. How are they so powerful, and how are they having such an outsized impact in the world? I was reminded of a story where there was a very small army in scripture. And of course, this small army were the good guys, in contrast to the Houthis, who are very clearly the bad guys in this situation. It's the story of Gideon in Judges 7. And if you're not aware of the story of Gideon, God calls Gideon, who's actually hiding from the Midianites. He's afraid, and the angel of the Lord comes to him, encourages him, and asks him to lead an army. And so he has 30,000 men show up. And the first thing that God tells him to do is to tell anyone who's afraid to go home, and 20,000 people leave. So 67% of his army's gone. And then God has him go through this very interesting vetting process. And if you look at the story, he takes everyone to the water and asks them to drink. And some of them drink kind of lapping the water like dogs. And the other ones just get down on their knees and bend over and drink out of the river. And it's a little bit confusing, but if you know the Jewish context, what he's actually trying to do is to decide who might worship idols and who does not worship idols, because idolatry was a big problem in Israel. And to worship idols, you got down on your knees. And that probably doesn't surprise you. That's kind of what we picture when someone worships an idol. They get down on their knees and they bow down to whatever their little trinket is. But an upright, beyond reproach Jewish man would not be caught in public down on his knees, even to get a drink of water, because it might give the appearance of worshiping idols. Well, the bad news is only 300 guys were willing to go to great lengths to not get on their knees. Everyone else gets cut loose. So now they have an army of 300 versus a very powerful army. And what God does is, instead of giving them, you know, bazookas and AKs, he gives them horns and pots. And he tells them to surround the top of the valley where the enemy is camping. And then in Judges 7:22, we see when Gideon's men blew their 300 ram's horns, the Lord caused the men in the whole army to turn on each other with their swords. And so this massive army actually ends up getting so confused that they begin killing each other. Okay, so what does this have to do with the Houthi pirates? Here's part of my perspective. The Houthis are capitalizing on three things: Western hesitancy, Western confusion, and Western lack of cohesion. The West right now is divided within itself. Look just at America, which is kind of the hegemon in the West. We are divided right down the middle in our country. We are so polarized that actual talk of civil war is happening in media and in political circles all the time. Hopefully, we're a long, long way away from that. But think about the 2024 election. We're looking at the Iowa caucuses, which Trump won. And immediately you have the majority of media and people who are on the opposite side, on the left, who are saying we have to do absolutely whatever it takes to make sure that Trump does not become the president. Now, according to polling right now, Trump has a sizable lead on Joe Biden in the primary election, which means if it's held tomorrow, he would likely be the president again. And you have people who are positioning themselves to not accept that result. On the other side, you have some percentage of people on the right politically who don't actually believe that Biden won the last election. Trump has a lead in the polls right now, which means if Biden does win the presidency back, assuming it's Trump versus Biden, then you have another percentage of the country who might not accept that result. So we're in a situation where either way we go, half of the country may not accept the results of the election that's going to happen. And we've all seen that it's leading to this. We have issues politically that divide us. We no longer think I'm right and you're wrong. We think I'm moral and you're evil. And it's both sides think that. They're moral, they have the ethical high ground, and the other people are evil. And they're talking about each other this way. We don't know who we want to be on the international stage. We don't know if we want to deter through strength or on a more populist take, if we want to be more isolationist and not try to be the world police. We don't have an identity. We don't have a unifying vision for the country. We don't understand even how to operate our own border and what we should do there. The Houthis are capitalizing on Western hesitancy, confusion, and lack of cohesion. And America truly no longer has a central uniting vision, and that makes us vulnerable to people who do. And so the Houthis are ragtag. They do not live in the affluence that we live in the West, the vast majority of people. Even those of us who are kind of middle income, driving older cars, you know, feel like sometimes we're barely making it by, cringing at the cost of, you know, milk and eggs and bananas. Even us, we are living in affluence to the people who are in the Houthis, except maybe the very top people who tend to make the most money. But they have a vision, and they are together, and they are unified. And it makes them dangerous. And we are hesitant, and we're confused, and we are not cohesive. In Proverbs 17:1, it says, better a dry crust with peace and quiet than a house full of feasting with strife. I think that might be America right now. A house full of feasting, all the convenience we could ever want, all the affluence we could ever want, anything we could ever want, all the opportunity we could ever want. But we're full of strife, full of confusion. The Houthis just have a dry crust. They're not living in affluence. They're living hand to mouth, many of them. Some of them living in absolute poverty. But they have unity. And they have direction. And the direction is maybe even evil. They are actively involved in terrorism. But they're together. And we need something that can unite us. And we need something to bring us back to the place, especially politically, where we are not demonizing half of the country on both sides of the aisle. Instead, we see ourselves as one country with many different ideas that can be debated and played out in the public sphere, the best ideas decided upon, and then we can move forward together. Until we get back to some kind of unity in our country, I think we're going to be vulnerable to anyone who has motivation and passion and clarity of vision. And now let's get to our last segment. Lil Nas X certainly knows how to draw attention to himself. His very first song, Old Town Road, came out. It was like the jam. Everyone played it everywhere. Kids loved it. And then as a parent, I actually read the words and realized that it's not actually as kid-friendly of a song as you would think. All of a sudden, once all the kids were hooked, then he came out as a huge, very vocal LGBT representative. Then he went into his Satanist era, where he put out a music video doing all kinds of debased things with Satan himself in the video. He started selling shoes that had the pentagram and were said to contain drops of actual human blood, just full on Satanism. About a month ago, Lil Nas X posted, "Do you mind if I enter my Christian era?" And this got a lot of people talking. That was followed up this week by a viral marketing campaign that had everything from him being hoisted up, crucified on a cross, to him just like jamming down a plate full of communion wafers and drinking the communion wine as fast as he could. All of that leading to last Friday, him releasing his newest song, which is simply called J Christ. Now, we're going to listen to some of this and hope we can avoid copyright strike. I'm going to click through. I'm not as worried about hearing the song as I am about the visuals. For those on audio only, I will describe it. It starts with a stairway to heaven. And on this stairway to heaven, there are kind of very poorly CGI'd celebrities. And so you have Kanye West, and you have Barack Obama, you have Michael Jackson, you have Oprah, and all of them are heading up on the stairway to heaven. Let's fast forward a little bit. We get up. So this is Lil Nas X now as a very, very feminine angel. He has a huge necklace on that says sexy, but it is twisted to where all you can see front and center is the word sex. Now, plot twist, he is going to go all the way down to hell.
Wow.
So he's back in hell. He's been in hell before in his music videos. We fast forward and he is playing basketball against the devil. He's gonna dunk on him. He makes the meme come true of Jesus crossing up the devil. Very feminine cheerleader in the heavenly courts, I guess. Okay, now we get to the part really is causing the blasphemy charges, maybe all of it. But now we have Lil Nas X on the cross. And the lyric is, which way are we going? This way. So he is a mock Jesus on the cross, crown of thorns, long tasseled go-go boots. The crowd hyped and cheering. Now we are a shepherd with clippers shearing sheep. We go on from here. He's at kind of the Met Gala. He has men kind of thirsting over him. At the end, he is Noah. He's leading all the animals to the ark. Kind of goes down into just a dance breakdown with cross imagery. Interestingly, at the very end, he puts up 2 Corinthians 5:17, which of course says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away, and behold, the new has come. And so there's me narrating the scenery and direction of Lil Nas X, J. Christ, which I'm sure stands for James, the brother of Jesus. No, it's Jesus Christ. And what he said was, let me enter my new Christian era. Here's the question. Is this art? And art is often meant to draw something out. Art is often meant to be provocative. Or is this blasphemy? Now, what we try to do here on the podcast is go into scripture and understand from a biblical prescription. I can see this. And as a Christian, as a pastor, my hackles kind of get raised when I see almost every second of this video, but this isn't about my feelings or my opinions. When you look at the word blaspheme, it's used actually quite often in scripture. It's from the Greek word blasphemeo. It is to speak evil of, to vilify, to defame, or to insult. And so if you're doing any of those things, then you fall into the category of a blasphemer. I don't think necessarily he is directly speaking evil about Jesus. I don't think he's vilifying him. As a matter of fact, if you pay attention to the lyrics, the best I understand them, is he is kind of putting himself in the Christ position, saying, I'm making a comeback. I'm stepping into a new era of Lil Nas X. I'm going to come out of the grave like the one who had the greatest comeback ever. Is he defaming Jesus? Well, there we get some real questions. And the bottom line is he insulting Jesus? I think the core question and the easiest path to blasphemy is, do you think that Jesus would be insulted by any of the depictions inside of this music video or any of the lyrics of this song, a song which uses foul language, which uses sexual language all throughout it? Would Jesus be insulted by this depiction? One of the interesting things I found as I was doing a simple word study on blasphemy is one of the uses in scripture, the one that I think is most pertinent to what we're dealing with here at a deeper level of what he's trying to accomplish with this song, came from one of the men that was hanging next to Jesus on the cross. If you remember, there were two men. One of them actually says, man, Jesus, if I can be with you in paradise, he actually confesses his belief in Jesus and the claims of Jesus. But the other one in Luke 23:39, one of the criminals hanging there began blaspheming him. Aren't you the Messiah? Save yourself and save us. The criminal who blasphemed wanted something from Jesus. Like, look, you're supposed to be all powerful. You're supposed to be able to heal people. You're supposed to be able to raise the dead. You're supposed to be able to do all of these things. Like, you're the king of heaven. Save yourself. And by the way, get me out of here as well. He wanted something from Jesus, wanted something out of this situation. And I think that at the core of how Lil Nas X is viewing his new Christian era is largely about stepping into the stream of something that already exists, which is Christianity, and seeing how he can profit from it. And I think one of the keys to understanding that comes from watching a video that he just recently posted, which he says is not really an apology, but is more of an explanation for what happened in the video and his intentions behind it. And so in the first couple of minutes, he just kind of says, you know, I wasn't trying to mock anyone. This wasn't like an FU to Christianity. And then we're going to look at the second half of the video where he kind of leans into what he's thinking and why he did what he did in this video. So let's check this out.
And I know, like, given my history with, you know, the Call Me By Your Name video, anything that I do related to religion can be seen as like mockery. That just was not the case with this. And I will say, though, with the communion video, with me eating the crackers and juice, I thought that video was going to be the video to lighten the mood, to take it down like less serious or whatnot. I thought that was something that we all wanted to do as kids or whatnot, but I didn't understand the idea of, you know, the reality of what it is. You know, it's me eating the communion, which is like the symbolism of like Jesus's blood and bones or something like that. I don't remember completely, but I did not mean it to as like a cannibalism thing or whatever the freak. But wow. I do apologize for that. I will say I am sorry for that. That was overboard. Though I don't agree with all of Christianity's rules or whatnot. I know not everybody follows Christianity by the book 100%, or, you know, the world would be a lot crazier.
So let's pause on that thought. Not everyone follows it by the book, or the world would be a lot crazier. A lot of what he depicts in his music video is crazy. And until very recent history, these were things that were far, far outside of the norm. And what we actually see, if you look throughout the course of history, is the world existed at a pretty high level of chaos. It certainly existed at a very high level of division. And the thing that brought that together was what we learn from the people who started the movement of Jesus, and we discover that in the book. So our faith does not hang on the book. It hangs on the event of the resurrection of Jesus. And that's going to be my whole message this Easter. So spoiler alert, if you're a part of Metachurch where I'm the lead pastor. But we discover the historical truths of the movement Jesus started and of the life of Jesus in the book, in the scriptures. And the scriptures are the word of God, and they are powerful and they are incisive. And the word of God, rightly understood, is the rule of faith in life. It shows us how to live at the highest maximal value. And if everyone actually lived by the book, rightly understood, the world would not get crazier. The world would finally be sane. And what you're going to hear throughout this is Lil Nas X has stepped into a Christian era, not stepped into a historical understanding of Christianity. I'll let him keep going.
But I do apologize for that. What was I going to say? This is not like to try to get everybody on my good side or whatnot. This is more so to clear my own head about my own decisions. I know, like, you know, I messed up like really bad this time. And I can act unbothered all I want, but it's definitely like taking a mental toll on me. What else do I want to say? I know this is not going to be like an immediate, like swift, everybody like moves forward or whatnot, but I do want my Christian fans to know that I am not against you. I was put on this earth to, you know, bring people closer together and promote love. And like, that's who I am. I'm not like some evil demon guy trying to destroy everybody's values and stuff like that. That's not me. What else was I going to say? Yeah. And also with the video, there's no disrespect there. I thought me clearly not being on the side of the devil in that video was like there was an understanding there that I'm not like trying to diss Christianity.
So he goes on from there, and I gotta tell you, I mean, I typically am just geared towards giving people the benefit of the doubt. You know, I appreciate him putting this out and kind of clearing his thoughts. Maybe accidentally what he did is really demonstrate a complete lack of knowledge about what Christianity is, the core tenets of the faith, what it's actually about. And he says, really just almost innocently, I thought since I was like in the one-on-one basketball game, I was against the devil and I dunked on him. I thought everyone was going to get like Christians. I'm on your side.
Wow.
The problem is, and what moves this into insulting and what moves this into kind of the category of blasphemy is throughout the video, he is doing things, saying things, behaving in ways that go against the commandments of God. And Jesus is God in human flesh. And so to personify Jesus and then also be doing things and saying things and dressing in ways that would be insulting to Jesus while you are playing basketball against the devil in the music video, you're not positioning yourself on the side of God through your actions and words. And Jesus makes it very clear, like, you're either a child of the Father or you're a child of the devil, a child of wrath. Like, you cannot serve two masters. And I think that at the core level, he ends his apology video, and there's a lot of rambling you have to go to get to it, but basically saying to my Christian fans, and that's kind of the giveaway right there. He is not considering himself a Christian. He's considering himself in a Christian era. And that's what he says. And I'm excited for you guys to see what I put out for the rest of my Christian era. In other words, this is a season. This is like a marketing ploy. I'm going to go through and I'm going to kind of milk it for all the attention I can get. And then I'm going to move on. And I don't know, you know, I'll give him the benefit of the doubt and say, maybe he is bothered by how much pushback he's getting. And maybe he didn't mean to just like completely spit in the face of Jesus and Christianity and Christians more broadly. Maybe he is just really that uninformed and that blind to it. Maybe he's the ultimate troll and he's even tricking me with a seemingly humble apology. But he's just moving through eras. He had his Billy Ray Cyrus kitty era. He had his kind of sexual forward era. He had his satanic era. Now he's in his Christian era. I think the core issue is Lil Nas X's misunderstanding of what Christianity is. It's not an era to step into and to benefit from. It's a commitment to submit your life to Jesus. Jesus said, if anyone wants to follow after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. And the song is like, I'm in this new era. This is my comeback. I'm blowing up. I'm going viral. And here he is. Everyone's talking about him. I'm talking about him on the Clayton Tyner podcast, the fastest growing podcast named the Clayton Tyner podcast. And he did it. He got all the attention for an entire week, and he will continue to do so until everyone has just grown so tired of it that he has to move into a new era and market that for all that it's worth. Jesus goes on to say, whoever wants to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life because of me will find it. For what will it benefit someone if he gains the whole world and yet loses his life? On the actual cross of Jesus, there were two criminals, one on either side of him. One of them wanted to know what he could get from Jesus. The other one wanted to just be with Jesus. And when we get to the place where more than fame, more than money, more than success, more than attention, more than going viral, more than love, more than sex, more than anything, we just want to be with Jesus, then we will step in to the level of fulfillment and true success in life that we've all dreamed about. I want to thank you for hanging in for episode 46 of the podcast. Make sure you subscribe. Let's keep pushing. Let's get out of the 800s. Keep getting this in front of more and more people. You can like, comment, and share. And if you want to support the podcast, go to patreon.com/Clayton Tyner. Again, depending on where you're watching this, you may still have time to get into this month's live Q&A, where we get to come together and have great, robust conversations with each other. So patreon.com/Clayton Tyner. I love you guys, and I'll see you on episode 47.